new people here, and thank you for inviting them. And it was exciting to see just God working in some fantastic ways. The stories that came back to me of people who haven't been to church or kind of stayed away from God, and for whatever reason were drawn to that, and God really worked with them on that. In particular, one gal told me she invited her daughter who didn't want to come and said, I don't want to go. I'll have to get all dressed up. She goes, no. The pastors wear jeans there. You can... And then she said when they came over there, she's like, boy, I hope they do wear jeans. We did. It all worked out. So anyhow, it was great to see what God was doing through all of that. Every year this time we get asked questions about year-end giving. And I know a lot of you are preparing your gifts for the year-end. Just make sure that they are either postmarked before the end of the year if you want to mail them to us. If you want to drop them by the offices, our offices should be open tomorrow and the next day, but just maybe call ahead just to make sure that we're going to be, there will be someone there that can receive it when you're there. The easiest way, of course, is just go on our website and you can make the donation there. And let me put this challenge forward too, that those of you who are part of this community, if you've never made a year-end gift or haven't given in a regular way, do that. Do that. Be a part of this church in a way that sustains it, moves it forward. And so go home this afternoon and pray with your spouse if you're married, or decide, go before God and say, figure out what you want to give, and then get on the internet and make that gift, or write the check, put it in the mail, and be a part of making a difference as a part of this community that God is doing so many fantastic things with. And if you are here this morning and you're new and you're like, this is my first time on a Sunday morning, or maybe you came Christmas Eve, there is a blue card. Andy talked about this a little while ago. We would love to have you fill that out, partly because we'd like to send you something in the mail this week, just a little gift for just being a first-time guest. And so if you'll just finish filling that out, you can drop it in the offering plate here in a moment. And of course, next week we start our new series, Come As You Are. And this is a series that in some ways picks up off of the theme of what we did for Christmas Eve. And it carries this notion that you don't have to be something special, that cookie cutter Christian or whatever, to come before God, to be a part of church, to start a spiritual journey. Come as you are. Your fears, your doubts, your joys, your struggles. Great series to invite someone to come to and be a part of. Well, ushers, if you want to go ahead and move forward, we're going to take up our gifts now at this part of the service here. And just a thank you to all of you who support this place in a financial way. It makes a difference. Let me pray. Father, right now we thank you for all that you did through the Christmas Eve service and working in hearts and lives and the way you touched us. We pray that you just continue to use this body of believers to do things that matter for eternity, things that impact lives in deep and significant ways. And it is a joy, God, to come and worship you and to be a part of this magnificent group of believers. And we pray this all in your Son's name. Amen.
VHS, that's a long ago. It came out. There's about a guy who suffered from, I think it's called Korsakoff syndrome, where you lose challenge and encourage you to think about going into this next year, not with the things that you have to get done, but to go into this year and to live as who you are in God, to think more about who am I, who is God, and who am I, and what does that mean for how I live my life? That is what we've got to remember that is so important. Now, to get that, I want to talk a little bit about this notion that in Scripture, there's kind of a theology to remember. It's the subject of theology. The Bible has a lot to say on this subject, and so this morning I'm going to go through a number of passages of Scripture. Here I don't have any one text in particular, and I'm not trying to drive at a line, but I hope that we all come out this morning with a different sense of what we want to hold on to going into this next year. So let's talk just a little bit about this notion that there's this theology or this teaching around remembrance. Flip over to Luke chapter 22. We're going to look at a number of passages. If you don't have a Bible, everyone flip there. We'll put most of the verses up on the screen. Luke chapter 22. And of course, this is with the Last Supper, and we had communion last week, and so this, you'll be kind of familiar with this. Here's what he says in verse 19. It says, "Then he took a loaf of bread, and when he had thanked God for it, he broke it into pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, 'This is my body given for you. Do this in what? Remembrance of me.'" Now, think about this for a moment. What is Jesus getting at in this moment? And remember, he's saying this to a group of people who have been following him for the better part of 3 years. And in these 3 years, they have seen him heal the sick, they have seen him work miracles. In these 3 years, they have watched him stand up to essentially the superpowers of the known world. He stood up to the Herods, to the high priests, to the Sadducees, to the Pharisees. I mean, they saw him do some really bold things. They watched him teach in ways that no one on this planet has ever taught with such greatness and authority. They watched him, for crying out loud, raise some people from the dead. Okay? Think about these 3 years. And Jesus is like, "Okay, I need you to do this so that you'll remember me." Right? And he's like, are we really thinking that they're going to forget? Well, in a way, yes. I think that's exactly what Jesus is getting at. Now, I don't think Jesus is thinking that, he's going to leave us into heaven and one day the disciples are going to wake up and go, "No, Jesus, who?" I don't think that's what he's driving at here, that somehow he's going to slip their minds in some way. I think what Jesus is getting at is he knows that he is leaving in physical form, and that the disciples are now getting ready to launch into this world with this new and great purpose, to start a church, to launch this movement of Christ that's going to do amazing things. But in that, they are going to face distractions and difficulties. They are going to face things that are going to draw their hearts away from what is most important. They are going to be drawn into things that will have their minds a little foggy on the things that are most important. And Jesus is understanding what they're moving into will draw them away from some really key things. And so when he says, "Remember, remember," he's trying to pull them to some very specific things. How many of you saw the latest Hobbit movie? Here, recently. Okay, quite a few of you. Okay. I think I told you this before. The Hobbit's one of my favorite books, and this movie captured one of my favorite parts of the Hobbit. And it's when they go into the Mirkwood Forest. And of course, Gandalf is getting ready to send the Hobbit and the dwarves. Thank you very much. Yeah, the dwarves and Bilbo into the Mirkwood Forest. Remember this? And Gandalf, because of some things going on, says, "I can't go with you. I can't go with you on this. But you've got to go in. This is your purpose. This is your quest. You've got to go in." But remember this. He keeps telling you, you've got to remember to stay on that path. Don't end on that. Yeah, no. You've got to stay on that path. And of course, the reason he does that is he knows you're going into this forest, and this is a forest that's going to draw you away. It's going to make your mind a little foggy. You're going to get in there, and there are going to be things that are going to pull you away. You're going to become really, really thirsty. And that wasn't the movie, but in the book he talks about that. All these things are going to pull you away, and he wants them to remember some of these most important things. And in a way, part of the human condition of living in this world is that we all have to go through our own Mirkwood forest at different moments. We all have those moments where it's not like we wake up one morning and go, "Jesus, who?" But we live in a world. 2014 will have Mirkwood forest moments for all of us. Moments that are going to distract us, pull us away from the things that are most important. And it may not be bad things, but it may not be the most important thing. And so, of course, the Hobbit fake, or the Hobbit and the dwarves, thank you very much, they go in there, and that trail is kind of symbolic of that thing that they've got to stick to, symbolic of the quest that they're on in some way. And of course, those things happen. It wants to pull them away. And in some ways, I would love for you to think of 2014 is holding some things that are really important in your life, and not just important for you. There may be some things that God puts before you that are important to this world, that he wants to do through you. And carrying the essence of that, of who you are, and the quest in some ways that God has put before you, is very important. But here's the issue. Being humans, we forget things really, really easy, don't we? That's just like a little exercise. I want you to think about this, the whole idea of forgetfulness here. I want you to think about how often you forget things, or how often you forget about things. For instance, have you ever forgotten somebody's name? Like somebody you just talked with like 10 seconds earlier, they told you your name. This happens to me all the time. Someone tells me their name, 10 seconds later, I'm like, and they just told me. How did that happen? Well, because I'm human. Or what about this? How many of you have forgotten your birthday or anniversary? Like your own anniversary. Okay, you don't raise your hand on this one. Yeah, it happens. How many of you have forgotten your car keys someplace? Yeah. How many of you have just forgotten where your car is when you leave church, right? I see this all the time. I'll be leaving after the third service, and I'll see people, they're kind of, and you just tell me, they're walking around the parking lot, and then they pull out their keys, and they start, pushing their, they're trying to get the, close enough to make the horn honk from the thing, It's just, what am I, the parking lot's so huge. How many of you, this is the one I hate the most, how many times have you ever, really deliberately walked into a room of your house to do something, and then you forgot, why did I walk into this room? I came in here to do something or to get something, and I just can't remember, because I forgot. We all forget things. It's a part of what it means to be human. But when you look at this notion of the theology of remembrance in Scripture, it's important to understand there's a distinction that it's making between just remembering information and forgetting the essence of something. And what I want to talk about here is this notion of the essence or the sense of something. That whenever Scripture is talking about remember something, it will talk about specifics, but it's getting at specifics that are to hold a deeper meaning of things. And as human beings, this is important because this is the way you were made and wired. Your heart, your soul was meant to carry deeper things. It's part of what it is to be human. So flip back to the book of Jeremiah, way back in the Old Testament. Jeremiah, and he makes this comment about these people. They're like off the track, they're off the trail, and they're struggling. Here's what he says. Now look at that. Jeremiah 50, verse 6 says this. "My people have been lost sheep. Their shepherds have led them astray and caused them to roam the mountains. They wander over mountain and hill, and catch this, and forgot their own resting place." Now, when he says they forgot their own resting place, he's not just saying, okay, well, they forgot where they live in their own, like when we who they are in God. They, at home, they were the people of God, and they lost that sense of who they really are. See, this is much more than just forgetting some important information. This is losing the sense of who you are. And this is an easy thing to do in our world, friends. Easier than you realize, because, of course, we live in a world that wants to pull us in thinking of ourselves in all the wrong ways. We live in a world that wants us to think of ourselves, our identity, in terms of what we accomplish, of what our physical attributes are, of the things that we have or own. It wants us to think of ourselves in terms of our roles in this world, what my career is, or am I a father, or mother, or a child, or a daughter. It wants us to think of all of those other things, and when we get pulled into those things, and again, none of those are bad, are they? But if that's all you have, I promise you, you don't have that deep sense of home. You don't have that deep sense of centeredness in who you are in God. God has created you to be someone much deeper than the things you do or the roles that you live out in this life. There are values and a nature to your character that is at the deepest levels of who you are, and that is something you need to have. So that becomes important. And so there is a key to know what to remember. In Deuteronomy, God is dealing with the Israelites, and he becomes frustrated with them because they're living in this way that is completely uncentered from who God has made them to be. And in Deuteronomy chapter 32, he says this. He says, is he not your father, your creator, who made you and formed you? And here's what he's saying in this moment. He's saying, do you not know, do you not realize that I'm your creator, that I'm the one that has formed you, that you are in me? It starts with God. And so you've lost this notion of who I've created you to be. Now, then look at verse 7. Here's part of the remedy of what he says you need to do, because it's important to know what to remember. And this is interesting what he tells them to do to get back to the sense of who they are. He says this, look at verse 7. Remember the days of old. So fix this, because I want you to remember something. Remember the days of old. Consider the generations long past. Ask your father, and he will tell you. Your elders, and they will explain it to you. And what he's wanting them to do is, I want you to go back, and I want you to remember. The story is what he's wanting to do. The interaction. I want you to remember how God has worked and lived in your life. I want you to get back to this notion of a life centered in God. He's asking them to remember their history with God. So when he's saying this, what he's wanting them to do then out of this, and we'll talk about this a little bit more here, this idea of remembering is this, and this is really important. It is to live with the ever-present thought that you belong to God. If there's anything you need to carry with you into 2014, if there's anything I would want you to wake up with tomorrow morning and carry into every activity of your day, it is to carry the ever-present thought that you belong to God. Because that will begin to center you in some very important things. So I want you to think back to the passage I read at the beginning out of Luke, when Jesus holds up that piece of bread and he says, do this in remembrance. What he's doing in that moment is he's saying, I want to pull, no matter how far out this place, no matter how far you get into that force, no matter how bad it gets, guys, I want you to remember this moment. And I want you to remember who I am in your life. I am your Savior. I am the one that broke my body for you. I am your God, your Savior, your Lord. See? And here's what's happening in a tangible way, and why we still practice communion today. Because here's what's going on. Here's what Jesus told us to do. And this is 2,000 years. Is that every time we practice communion, in a way, we are taking what happened some 2,000 years ago in a historical past, and we're making that history present. Does that make sense? When we practice communion, we're bringing the essence of the past forward in a very real way. Remembering allows what was real in the past to be experienced in the present. That's why all through Scripture you see this theology of remembrance. And God is always telling you, I'm following, I want you to remember the stories of your forefathers. I want you to remember what happened with Abraham. I want you to remember what happened with Joshua. Because I want you to take what was there, the essence of that, and bring it forward and live with that reality in this moment, because this is getting at who you are. Oftentimes in Scripture you see these moments where he's saying, I want you to remember how God delivered the Israelites. And he says this again throughout the Old Testament. I want you to remember how I brought the Israelites out of captivity. Why? Because that is a picture of salvation. That we need to carry that essence of we're saved in Christ even now. And when we remember that, we remember that the God who saves us, we're to remember the way God called Abraham a friend. Because you know what? You can have that same relationship with God. We're asked to remember things like what God did with Moses or Esther, how he got a hold of their lives, guys like Peter, changed them, and put them on a new course with a kind of purpose that was unbelievable. And the reality is, friends, you have that same purpose that is God-given in your life. Think about this. God has provided salvation for you. He has offered you friendship, and he has bestowed purpose on your lives. And we've got to remember that. We've got to carry that with us, because to live with that is very, very empowering in a hectic, fast-paced world that has all of the demands on. I want you to see how this plays out in the book of Ephesians here. And then I want to draw out some application with this. Over in Ephesians, Paul brings this out a little bit. It's fascinating how he does this. Over in Ephesians chapter 2, he's trying to help the church in Ephesus grab a hold of this deep understanding here, and it's going to involve all three of these things. First, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 13 says this, but now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. He said, you understand, you were so far from God, separated from him, and it is through Christ that you found salvation. Nothing in this world keeps you from the love of God. You have been drawn close to God through Christ. That to be a Christ follower is to have that salvation. Then he walks through this, how there are all these other people that have this relationship, and it's this deep like friendship that they've had. Then he gets down to verse 22, and he includes all of us. Look at verse 22, and he says, and in him, you two are being built together, along with all these other believers that have come before us. You two are being built together to become a dwelling in God, in which God lives by his Spirit. I want you to just think about this for a moment, okay? What Paul is saying is God lives inside of you. You have the most, that is part of who you are. You're the dwelling place of God. That is why Scripture says, and Abraham was accounted a friend of God. Or think about this, is amazing. There's a moment, we won't turn there, but over in John, I think chapter 15, there's a moment where Christ is talking with his disciples. And he says these amazing things. Lord, and then I'm speaking as your pastor. I want you to carry that essence, the beauty of that truth into 2014. Whatever you face, good, bad, filled with joy, filled with tears, what you carry into this next year, more important than anything you accomplish, is that if you are a follower of Christ, you're a friend of Christ. And what's even more beautiful is he describes then why he would call you friend. One of the reasons he would call you friend, he says this, is because you know the business of God. And what he's getting at there in that moment is, there are purposes, there are dreams and desires that God has for this world, things that he wants to do with hurting people, things that he wants to do to bring beauty into this world in the most amazing ways. And you know what? He wants you to be a part of that business, that deal, that dream, those desires. You are a part of that. See? And it's so easy sometimes to be pulled into just the swirl of all the things in this world. But what if you went into 2014 carrying in that sense of, I found salvation in Christ. I've been counted a friend of God. And there are purposes, there is a kind of quest that he has put before me that is bigger than me, that my life is to be about. Carry that notion into 2014, and I promise you, it will make a lot of your problems feel small. It will empower you to overcome those difficulties. It will give you a sense of joy that can't be experienced in just what this world has to offer. So, let me just take a few moments here and talk about what can we do? And I'm going to get really practical here for a little bit, okay? What are some things that we can do to just not forget that, to hold on to the sense of remembrance or essence of what is most important, okay? So I'm just going to get that, I'm just going to get really practical.
Surfing, and I just haven't found it yet, but when I do, I think it's buried in some obscure Greek meaning someplace, but I'll find it, I'll teach it, and we'll get there, but I'm sure. So I go surfing, and I'm just going to go by myself.
control me. And I'm like, fuck, just pray and just pull it. And I realize God is saying, Glenn, you're coming with this problem, and what you're really wanting is to try and control me, and you can't put me in a box. I'm not that kind of guy. And I just was kind of overwhelmed at this moment of just how much, I guess I really was trying to control God. And what was happening was, I wanted an answer from God on this particular issue before I acted. Because the truth was, I kind of wanted God on the hook and not me on the hook. And it's kind of this thing where I said, God, you tell me the answer, and I'm going to do it. And then you have to do X, Y, and Z based on your answer. So you give me the answer for the right outcome, and then you better make sure the right outcome happens. And it was a really humbling moment to just realize, I'm trying to control God. And that's not what I want my life to be about. And the next thing that I really felt just impressed upon with God in that moment was that what God was saying was, I am with you. And that's enough. What you're going to face in this, you've got to go out, and you've got to face it and make decisions and live it out without certainty to anything other than, I am with you. And that is enough. And I kind of carry that in a lot of things in life, in different situations, moments where I want to control something that I feel threatens me or threatens someone around me. And maybe what threatens you is something with an illness or your body or cancer. Or maybe it's something that threatens you financially or something. You know, and we all have those things. And there was this thing where God was saying, I am with you, and that is enough. And it was a powerful moment for me, and I realized I've got to carry this into my life, my ministry, my relationships. And I only shared that story with a couple of people when I got back and just said, you know, just wow. And one of my friends, I shared this with, said this, and he said, what are you going to do to mark that moment, that story, so you don't forget? And what do you mean? What are you going to do that's symbolic in your life to mark that moment so you don't forget? Because that's powerful. And that really grabbed me. So here's what I did. And I don't do this lightly at all, okay? Because it involves a surfboard, okay? I went and got a Sharpie marker and actually wrote a little spot on my surfboard. Because, you know, you don't mess with Sharpies with your surfboard. But I wrote a little Greek word that means something to me that marks that moment. I wrote it on there. And now every time I go surfing on that surfboard, it reminds me of that moment out in the ocean where God talked to me. It reminded me that I don't get to control Him, but He is with me, and that is enough. And that I need to remember. I need to carry the essence of that, that He is my Savior and my friend. And He is the one that puts the greatest purposes before me in this life. So let me ask you a question now. What are you going to do to mark what is most important about what God is saying or doing in your life? Maybe something happened this past year and you say, that was a significant moment of what God did in my life. Do something symbolic so that you don't forget what is most important and carry that into this next year and see what it does for you. Why don't you stand? And before I close this, I just want to remind you, if